Welcome back, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us today. I'm Georgia Gillan, a research manager here at IFTF in the Equitable Futures Lab. And in this session, we're going to be diving into the intersection of climate change and the economy. So at the Institute, we quote William Gibson a lot. And one of our favorites is, the future is already here. It's just not evenly distributed. And this is quite apt for climate change as well. Climate change is here. It's already happening. But depending on our geographical location, our economic security, among other important factors, we don't necessarily feel the gravity of the crisis every day. And evidence of climate change has been around for decades. We know we need to decarbonize the economy, but it's hard to adapt and definitely hard to transform when the structure of our economic systems is designed to extract as much value as possible, which manifests as destroying the planet. So it's driven by profit maximization and financial gain, which doesn't lend itself well to investing in activities that create social and environmental value, things we really need to be investing in. So our guiding question for this economic and financial lens is really, how do we reimagine institutions and structures to match our 21st century needs within the limits of the environment? So to help us think through this question, I'm thrilled to say we are joined by expert Kevin Bayuk, who is partner at Lyft Economy, that's Lyft with an I, by the way, and is a senior financial fellow at Project Drawdown. Kevin has a deep knowledge of systems thinking, climate finance, ecology, and permaculture. So we invited Kevin because we want to understand the following more deeply. What are the key tensions in implementing decarbonization and climate change mitigation strategies, as well as what are some low-hanging fruit opportunities? The second thing, what is a climate-positive organization? How do they stand currently? How will they look like in the next 5 years, the next 30 years? And thirdly, we want to take a systems approach underlying all these decisions and activities in the current structure and boundaries of the economy that drive value extractive behavior. How do we shift away from value extraction to value creation? So to give you a sense of how this session will run, Kevin is going to kick us off with a state of the state, and then we'll get into our interview. Please send questions in the Vantage Point chat or YouTube comments, depending on how you're watching. And Kevin, I will hand it over to you.
Thank you, Georgia, and thank you everyone in attendance for this very important conversation. So in the state of the state, I wanted to just share some of my observations pertinent to kind of this discussion. And where I wanted to start with is this image, which I think if you're not yet familiar with, I think it's something that's really important for us all to get our head around. What the warming stripes here is, it's a visualization of kind of the departure from average temperatures, each line representing a year from 1850 at the left to 2020 at the right. Blue is cool, you know, below average, and red is the warm years. And so I'm kind of stating the obvious, but it's good to have some visual indications of what is going on, with 2020 being either tied for or the warmest year on record. But what that means is, I think, hard to grasp sometimes. What we saw in 2020, for example, at the Arctic Circle and actually both of the poles, is an unprecedented level of warming that wasn't really anticipated, honestly, until by climate prognostications, until maybe 2080s. So over 100 degrees Fahrenheit being one of the kind of indicators at the Arctic Circle. And I'll come back to why this is important and relevant. But then we also saw probably the hottest recorded temperature on Earth in Death Valley, also in 2020. We also, of course, those of here us on the West Coast, like in California and the United States, like myself, also in Australia, of course, saw an unprecedented scale of conflagration and fire. And of course, we had the hurricane season on 2020, on a record-breaking year. But not just warming, things that we associate with warming. We had record-setting snowdrops in fall and winter, in fall in the United States, as an example. The worst floods on record in China. the worst floods in Sudan, the 100-year kind of flood experience. And these extreme events, I'm just highlighting something that we already know, and I'm not trying to bring up everybody's anxiety level. But when we think about climate beneficial organizations and anything around this provocation, the first thing that I'd like to emphasize is that right now, resilience, being resilient to extreme events, is probably an important frame, definitely for this moment now and for the rest of our lives. Because if what we can anticipate over the next 10 years and actually for the rest of our lives is, whereas you looked at those stripes, the last 10 years being the warmest on record, they also are likely to be the coolest over the next 100 years. And so what we've already baked in is an extremism. For every year, we'll probably see the largest this, the smallest that, the coldest this, the hottest that. And extremism is what's the counter to extremism is resilience. And so what do I mean by resilience when it comes to organizations? I'll give one example here, like in PG&E in California, an energy utility in Northern California. After some fires in 2017, they came out with a disclosure that said their estimated potential financial impact from wildfires, they estimated around $2.5 billion. Those of us here in Northern California know what happened then is we had extensive fires where PG&E ended up filing for bankruptcy protection and was facing up to $30 billion in fire liabilities. So how do we get from a disclosure that estimates their financial exposure at $2.5 billion, and then within 1 year's time, the $30 billion was the imminent liability that was being faced? So resilience and preparing for resilience is important. And there are organizations that are doing it, that are preparing for resilience. And maybe we'll come back in discussion with Georgia on some of these case studies. Dr. Bronner's is a privately held company in kind of the healthcare or health personal product space, soaps and so forth. And they've done some very interesting things in their supply chain that I'll come back and highlight in terms of how does one organization invest in resilience. So resilience is theme number one when looking at what's happening, what we can anticipate. The second theme in the state of the state that I want to bring up is this idea of, well, okay, preparing and adapting and being more resilient is an important frame to think about. But how do we, from a project drawdown perspective, how do we address the global warming in general? Is there nothing we can do about it but just prepare to be more resilient? Well, in fact, 2020 is a fascinating year because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Worldwide emissions are falling, which is the biggest drop over the last, the biggest drop over definitely over the last century in terms of emissions. In fact, the current forecast, and we'll get the final accounting for it in the next few months, looking at emissions from 2020, but it basically could theoretically put humanity on track to the Paris Accord kind of commitment to a 1.5 degree warming world, 1.5 degrees centigrade. And of course, you know, immediately you're thinking, okay, that's great that emissions dropped in 2020. But if I told you that the answer to global warming was that everybody had to shelter in place and stay home and that we had to crush the global economy, that doesn't make sense. But it's a powerful provocation to know that beyond the realm of science fiction, that we actually, there is a possibility of reducing our emissions and putting ourselves on a path. And that's where the work of Project Drawdown comes in, I think, importantly, is with our global analysis published in the book in 2017, as well as the Drawdown update published in 2020. We have done a scan of existing technologies and practices and strategies that already have at least 1% adoption within their addressable market. So not coming attractions, not things that are in a lab or at a feasibility or research and development stage, of which there's many interesting technologies and approaches, but things that are actually in existence, wind turbines, solar photovoltaics, silvopasture, agricultural practices, different approaches to nature-based solutions, as well as mitigation and energy efficiency and diversified renewable energy solutions. And what we calculated is that with feasible adoption scaling of existing practices, that it is possible for humanity to kind of match the Paris Accord targets and goals, and in fact reach a world where year over year we have a drawdown or a reduction of carbon equivalency content in the atmosphere. That is a possible and feasible pathway using existing technologies over the next 30 years, that we can get to that type of target without destroying the economy or having everybody have to shelter in place. And all of the solutions are important. There's a mosaic of 80 solutions that we measured, mapped, and modeled, including 20 coming attraction solutions that are more in the feasibility stage or proof of concept stage. And so when we think about climate benefits, state of the state, you could ask yourself, is this happening? Are organizations doing things? And the answer is yes, but I want to bring up the second theme. What's the barrier to adopting those technologies and practices? If Drawdown has calculated using peer-reviewed literature that it's possible, what is the barrier? And there are a number of them, but the one that I want to bring up is returns. So resilience was the first theme. Returns is the second theme. And returns, what I mean by returns is when we look at the IRRs of investing in various strategies for carbon, low carbon activities, carbon mitigation activities, or greenhouse gas emissions reductions activities and strategies. So within a corporation or some other entity, these return profiles don't always match up to the hurdle rate for investments. So our culture of evaluating investments based on return profiles, it's not that there's not a net present value of future cost savings for some of the technologies, but oftentimes compared to existing investments or other opportunity costs, investment opportunities, we can't necessarily eclipse the hurdle rate. This is some data from 2014, so dated now, but is a great study of IRRs of different types of approaches. And in some cases, you do have fantastic return possibilities. And that would be the low-hanging fruit side, is where are the returns actually eclipsing the other opportunities, investment opportunities. And there are, within almost any organization, there are opportunities. But some of the more difficult things to do that with longer, more patient return profiles just don't have the IRRs. For what it's worth, there is some updated data, just not as comprehensive across organizations, from Davale and Sarkis, stochastic internal rate of return on investments in sustainable assets, that was published in Computers and Operations Research in 2018. So this I also believe is a place where sharing data on IRRs could be a motivator. And IRR in return is one barrier. It's not the only barrier, but it's an important one. So resilience, returns, and these return profiles don't always match up, there is action. And I want to return to some case studies of organizations that are doing the low-hanging fruit, where the return profile is eclipsing their hurdle rate. And IKEA, and the Inca Foundation are definitely doing some very impressive work with their renewable energy goals, and we can talk about that. And there are groups and initiatives coming together of organizations, corporations, that are kind of taking these, building syndicates and communities of practice, whether it's Drawdown Labs, an initiative out of Drawdown, the C40 Cities, or the Renewable 100, the RE100 Climate Group out of the Climate Disclosures Project. There's also another case study to mention is there's other initiatives that are looking at getting on the scale, measuring your scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3 emissions, and then using offsets as strategies. Offsets are potentially very problematic culturally, and then verifying offsets in these voluntary carbon markets has some other problematic aspects. But in terms of harm reduction, a best practice approach to offsets can be valuable. And there are brands and organizations taking action there. And again, when George and I go into conversation, we can mention some of these case studies. And beyond offsets on this kind of trajectory or continuum is looking at insets. And those of you who are not familiar with insetting, we can talk about Pierre Progey or General Mills with their recent commitment to advance regenerative agriculture on 1 million acres of farmland by 2030 in their supply chain. So there's some very interesting work happening on looking at the activities of an organization and actually changing business practices so it's not an offset, but it's an inset to actually reduce their emissions to become some type of net zero target. Returns, resilience, returns. The third thing I want to mention in the state of the state before we go into kind of conversation, which I'm anxious to do, this idea of risk. And I just want to highlight that I think in the same way that it's difficult to grapple with what happened in 2020 and all the extremism from global warming and climate change, the risks that organizations are looking toward are coming from not just like the direct risks of wildfires interrupting supply chains or floods and so forth. Those are important and evident, but there's some subtle risks that are inexorable kind of slow, chronic type of risks that are very difficult to get our heads around. And I just want to mention one in the form of sea level rise. If those of any organization here in the San Francisco Bay Area might be surprised to note that one of the risks to every one of our organizations or even anybody who lives here is the inundation risk of our sewage treatment facilities. Sewage treatment facilities are usually in low-lying areas because they are fed by gravity and controlled by gravity so as to avoid heavy emissions and expensive energy expenditure to treat wastewater. But we have a number of sewage treatment facilities, including the one that services Palo Alto, that are literally at risk of inundation, especially on king tides, within the next 10 years. So within the next 9 years now. And so can you imagine what it means for an organization with offices in Palo Alto or workers in Palo Alto when literally you can't flush toilets for weeks during the year? And the cost of addressing these type of societal risks related to things like sea level rise are very difficult to fathom. In just the Bay Area alone, you're looking at tens of billions of dollars to address what this one problem with sewage treatment facilities, not to mention international airports and other assets that are at risk. So that's where I wanted to stop with the sharing of the state of the state, is to look at these kind of three areas: resilience, returns, and risk, as some of the things that are informing some of the action. And there is action, and there are potentials. And I think George and I will go into what a climate beneficial or climate positive organization might do in response to these barriers and opportunities.
Thank you so much, Kevin. Yeah, let's dive right into that. If you could, let's definitely talk more about the case studies from the perspective of the climate positive organization. And so what are the characteristics of a climate positive organization? Can it still be profitable? Is that actually something that can happen today? And what would that look like in the future?
Yes. So can an organization be climate positive? So right now, the majority of action is on even the accounting side of how impactful are we? What is our emissions profile? And so there's still an effort around disclosure and accounting and understanding the impact. Then there's a question of like, okay, how can we begin to mitigate and reduce harm in terms of our impact? And there's a tremendous amount of action there. You could go all the way to the other end of the spectrum, and the long term of the spectrum is like, how can the activities of an organization actually be not just mitigating harm or reducing emissions, but actually biosequestering carbon out of the atmosphere, restoring biodiversity, enhancing living systems, and doing social repair to be a force of actually being climate beneficial. Mm-hmm. And so is it possible? Yes, I believe there are, I don't believe there is a climate beneficial large corporation, and let's say in the public equities market, that we could say that is a climate beneficial organization throughout all of its activities. Mm-hmm. I think those that are looking at modifying their business model to deliver goods and services, and looking at the way in which those goods and services are provisioned, where the impact is a net reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, are the ones that are trending towards the closest type of impact. But it's going to be very difficult for a multinational to do that. And we mentioned General Mills. So General Mills's commitment to look at their supply chain and actually invest in transforming farmer practices to known practices, no-till, cover crops, and other regenerative agriculture practices, not just organic agriculture, which can still be net emissive, but actually looking at regenerative agriculture practices. Over 1 million acres by 2030 is their goal. But one can imagine in your mind's eye, what if an organization who has a supply chain that touches nature-based solutions, so anything that grows, whether that's timber for building materials or anything touching food or fiber, you have this opportunity to actually change the practices on the ground to when you take an emissions profile or greenhouse gas emissions profile, it is possible to conceive that an organization can actually have a net gain in terms of carbon capture mm-hmm. compared to whatever they might emit from their scope one and scope two emissions, or even their scope three emissions. So that concept is possible. I think the majority of the action you'll see right now and for the next 10 years will be on trying to reduce emissions. So diversified renewable energy, changing out the fleet from internal combustion engines to electric vehicles, those types, or looking at the built environment and looking at energy efficiency, whether it's LED lighting or insulation in buildings. There's a number of strategies that can be taken, and those are doable in a large part, but also fraught with this IRR problem. Mm-hmm. On the far extreme, and if you want me to go there, Georgia, there are, I could hint at, we could either use this at the end or in response to questions. Mm-hmm. I believe there's a crisis of the imagination of what world would look like if organizations were authentically climate beneficial in their supply chain. And I have some real non-science fiction examples, but they do bend our imagination about what's possible.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, let's talk about that right now. That's
okay. Great. I'm going to share my screen again then and show some images from some some efforts that are underway. So if you can see this, do we see the forest thinning?
Yes.
Okay. So when you take, for example, the amazing risk that we have in the undermanaged forests of the world, Australia and California come to mind right now, especially in places where indigenous practices through genocidal colonialism have been, there's an erasure of those practices. So you have fire suppression. Fire in these Mediterranean climates is necessary as nature's recycling method. And so you have these incredible carbon loads of all these growth of trees that are less than normal timber harvesting scale of trees. And so thinning these round pole type trees is something that can be done, but it's typically associated with as a cost center rather than a revenue center. The thinning in this case for the type of carbon load that is really making these fires burn really hot and fast, that type of understory growth is doesn't make for traditional milled timber type of yields. However, there's innovation. There's a company called Whole Trees that is actually developing trusses and taking round pole timbers with an amazing weight to strength ratio, very comparable to steel, and over with some innovative processes, being able to select and grade and structure these trusses, they're approaching cost equivalency with recycled steel to span, to actually develop into buildings. So one can imagine with innovations like round pole trusses and cross laminated timber, CLT, which this building is representative of. These are techniques where we could actually use forest thinnings, which are reducing risk, increasing resiliency, and actually creating buildings that with some marriage of wood or even straw, grass, cellulose, and earthen plasters that are fire resistant. You can imagine having buildings where that standing building that you would be looking at or living in or working in is itself a carbon sequestering event. It's not just a building that is low energy in terms of its operations, but the building itself is sequestering carbon in terms of the materials that are embedded into it. And that, what I just shared, it's a vision that sounds like science fiction, but it's actually happened. This Mahonia building in Eugene, Oregon, is literally has done rigorous measurement, and you know there's about 12 metric tons of carbon sequestered within the walls and structure of the building. And so that's including the whole life cycle of the costs and energy in doing the construction. And that's an impressive figure. And it's impressive to me because it is not necessarily immediately feasible on a cost basis, but with innovation and commitment, humanity could imagine for all the rebuilding that we're going to have to do, moving away from the coasts and responding to fires, as well as any of the new building we might do to accommodate population growth or industrial growth, that every single building that humanity creates could be in and of itself a carbon sequestering event. And so that's the type of like long tail, far edge of innovation that's possible. And I could go into another example if you'd like.
Yeah.
Another example would be in the world of fiber. I have the distinct privilege to work with Winona LaDuc of the Anishinaabe and Ojibwe people in Minnesota. And Winona is intent on developing a seed to garment replicable tribal hemp industry to grow hemp to turn into clothing. And what's important there is when you look at the world of natural fibers, that most clothes at this point are polyester and plastic, or at least the majority. But the 40 or so percent of clothing that are still natural fibers, most of it's cotton. And the vast majority of that is cotton. Of course, cotton has a problematic both history and current footprint. It's the largest water-using crop besides alfalfa in the world, responsible for a tremendous amount of desertification. It also uses more insecticides, pesticides, than any other crop in the world, which has enormous health impacts and watershed impacts. And what in the world of fashion and textiles and whole cloth and garments, using bast fibers and hemp has been problematic in terms of the processing. So what's happening right now is there's innovation to take these long bast fibers off of the stalks of plants like hemp, and to actually decorticate and degum, and there's some equipment innovation that's happening to create fibers that can be spun and blended with other fibers. And there's a group called Fibershed, a nonprofit that has been doing proof of concept work on blending bast fibers from hemp with wool from sheep that are grazed regeneratively. In fact, the sheep, and through a managed grazing strategy, through a carbon sequestering managed grazing strategy, can actually graze the stubble off of the hemp fields, which makes for very happy sheep, apparently. And the blending of wool and hemp creates a naturally antimicrobial, soft as cotton, very durable material, whole cloth, that you can imagine a world where every garment in your wardrobe is itself a carbon sequestering event. And so the far side of our imagination, but it's not science fiction. It is absolutely feasible But of course, getting the cost profile. So that's the type of long tail innovation that you can imagine, where I could imagine a whole industry being climate beneficial, the building industry, the textile industry. Yeah. And these are, of course, you know, on the aggregate $1 trillion industries combined together. So that's there's substantial opportunity. I'm not saying it's simple or easy, but that's right. You know, wanted to highlight the possibilities.
Yeah, that's incredible. So given that not everyone can do this right away, going back to sort of the low hanging fruit opportunities, and one thing you said about carbon offsets was that they could become culturally problematic. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. I'm hoping you can talk a little bit more about that. And if people are using carbon offsets now, what's the next step they can take? And you mentioned insetting. Mm-hmm. And if you can talk more about that, sort of taking into account the cost of inaction.
Right. Yeah. And so the cost of inaction piece, that I'll come back to that, because that's important in coloring this whole field, right. Is the right now, the return profiles that we see from doing insetting or innovation or taking strong action across the board on drawdown solutions, which are existing strategies and practices, mm-hmm. Is influenced by our discounting of risk or externalizing risk. We're very bad at pricing risk and understanding it. And I think, again, the PG&E example comes to mind. And so this the cost of inaction is an ever-increasing risk profile that is very difficult to grasp. Yeah. And so there's disclosure work, and there are attempts, and there's action happening to try and get our heads around that risk to be able to influence the return profile of taking action today. In terms of taking action today, what the current kind of possibilities look at: getting on the scale, doing your measurements, doing your disclosures, then looking at offsetting. Now, in the world of offsetting, why I say it's culturally risky or challenging is there's a growing movement, especially from the global south and, of course, from indigenous communities that are looking at market-based mechanisms, in particular, credits and offsets, as being continually in, the discourse around it is that offsets are essentially a mechanism to continue to do emissions which are harming people the most who have been most marginalized today. Mm-hmm. So it's a continual assault or a continued form of colonial exploitation of marginalized peoples, who are the ones who are most vulnerable and who are currently already tens of millions, if you add 2019 and 2020 together, migrating due to climate disaster. And so continuing emissions, even if you're doing offsetting, which takes time to have the impact, a lot of offsets, especially nature-based solutions, take a certain number of years or decades before they have their full potential sequestration impact. Oftentimes, a lot of verified offsets have a 10-year horizon for the kind of the forwarding of the amount of the offset for the activities today. And so you have emissions happening today, which are increasingly creating harm. And then there's this whole discourse of creating a marketizing, if you will, of relatives or natural assets. And I call it a cultural issue. I think there's very real issues with offsets and kind of obfuscation and
not getting to the core of the actual problem.
Leakage, and yeah, it's a partial distraction. Can offsets create harm reduction, and can offsets that have a strong social justice and repair component, centering and empowering, uplifting, and by centering, I mean the leadership of indigenous peoples, marginalized peoples of the world, especially in the global south, but anywhere in the world, having control, autonomy over the utilization of resources to do offsetting to meet needs, especially around food security or land tenure. There is the potential to have offsets, but that we might have to change some of the labeling and jargon, because I believe, again, there's a significant cultural risk around our continued addiction to offsets as an easy solution. The harder solution is, like you said, going along the continuum to looking at our practices or business model even, and saying, how can we begin to inset and look at how we provision and create our goods and services or supply our goods and services, and change those practices so that all of our activities are actually the place where the emissions reductions occurs. So we have emissions from using power in our processes or operations or buildings or whatever, and then or our fleet, et cetera. And how can we change our actual business practices in our supply chain rather than externalizing some type of offset somewhere else outside of our business itself? So a deep insetting work, and Pierre Projet coming out of a small chocolate company, Alter Eco. I mentioned General Mills as an example. This insetting work is more difficult, but that's along that continuum before we get to the deeper innovation of truly climate beneficial supply chains and different work there.
Right. And so the entire structure of the economy is supporting and not supporting these efforts. And so what are the characteristics of the next economy that would reward these socially valuable, environmentally valuable activities over financial value? Like, how does that even happen? We have 10 minutes.
10 minutes. Yeah. I mean, we could speak to kind of the current efforts that are underway. But I don't want to be too cynical, but there's a whole school of thought that suggests that consumer preferences will and are trending towards rewarding organizations that have authentic action and commitments. And I think there's probably some truth to that, and there's some mechanisms for being a standard bearer, and some of the slide with the different organizations and efforts, whether it's the Renewable 100 as an example there, and of course the B Corp certification as an example of this better practices in terms of treating how one treats the environment or communities, and then finding some recognition for that in the market. And I do think there is some validity to that, but in the when I said I don't want to be too cynical, I would suggest that those rewards and that mechanism and relying on consumer preferences to be the mechanism that creates that raise above the IRR hurdle feeds directly into the current capital mandates and extractivism that capitalism is famous for. And so I think we have this risk of actually relying on the consumer to be the determining factor to change, say, corporate behavior, organizational behavior. But nonetheless, that action is happening, and I believe there is potentials for harm reduction. That climateneutral.org branding is an example of that type of appeal to that type of preference. And I believe there is a driver there. I just wouldn't rely on it. Right. We talked about the other driver of being the actual risk, and that risk will show up first in disclosures and then ultimately in recognizing or feeling the risk as it actually impacts, organizations and supply chains and companies. I think the bigger opportunities are kind of reform, societal reform and cultural reform. By reform, there's both reforming, there's regulation. So looking at different possibilities from a policy perspective to change the mandate, either for capital or for businesses in general. And so there you have some of the policy in the United States, for example, that Elizabeth Warren and the Bernie Sanders campaign were putting forward, whether they'll make it into some of the final legislation that the Biden administration will be able to move forward, we'll see. But there are overtures to actual structural reform to both capital mandates and the nature of what businesses would be allowed to do. So regulation is one piece that could be a big driver. Another driver, of course, would be just the general culture. So this is close to that consumer message, but I have a bit more faith in terms of the cultural reform. When you look at the youth around the world, you see there's almost zero climate denial. And so just the shifting of, as the youth come into more and more power in the world, which will happen just in the generational flow, and maybe accelerated by direct action, I think that has the potential for a more heavy-handed structural reform. Voluntary structural reform in terms of corporations would be organizations that are looking at changing the ownership profile of their business. By the way, when I said like the Sanders and Warren, some of the interesting reform efforts would be looking at the shift from short-termism to long-termism. Right. And again, there's also voluntary efforts there, like the long-term stock exchange, which I think those are very interesting to track and advocate for. But that you could see that a long-term mandate for capital and a long-term orientation for business valuation would change everything in terms of the reward profile and the motivation to take actions, actions that would hurt an organization in the short term, but absolutely benefit society and those organizations in the long term. So long-termism is a theme that we need to look at across the board. The voluntary structural reforms is, there's a whole emerging movement around steward ownership and whether that's through vehicles like perpetual purpose trusts or other, and this is especially in privately held companies. But that movement, I believe, is beginning to scale. And that movement I would associate with the broader movement of reforms of capitalism, which is all moving far too slow, but is very exciting for its potential. By changing the ownership of organizations, you could change the incentives, which are currently locked into kind of business as usual mandates and even fiduciary responsibilities that are actually encoded into law. So we do want to change those laws, but voluntarily, we can get around all of that if we change the ownership.
Right. Yeah. So government regulation does play a key role here as well. Do you see a future where public-private partnerships are the norm?
We're the norm. Well, yes, I do actually. I do. I can say I'm hopeful about that. The obvious challenge to anybody living in the United States, as an example, is that you have kind of the capital capture of governance, which is a very challenging problem to back out of. And that has to do with campaign finance and so many other things around lobby. And there's we're at a kind of a stalemate. There are efforts and there have been efforts. And I can definitely advocate for those efforts. And again, if I look to the youth, that's where I can feel most optimistic about actually seeing some of those changes happen. But if you look to where is climate action in the affluent world, where's the most progressive climate action? And your attention will go to Scandinavian countries and places where the public-private orientation of enterprise is structurally different and distinct from what we see in the United States. And so because you're seeing success there, and that success of action there, we'll see that accelerate, especially as the risk profile of the world changes. I believe more attention will be brought there, and hopefully, say the youth in the United States or other places in the world will say, hey, maybe that type of model is something we want to look at where we live. And so I'm not trying to pedestalize or glorify the the Scandinavian model as perfect, but definitely I think there's a lot to learn there, and we do see more attention being drawn there.
Yeah. Okay. So we have one question from YouTube. Can you recommend any educational infographics or other resources that can be useful when communicating economic and climate concepts from today's conversation with people who are new to this topic?
That's a great question.
We can also send out this information after the talk.
Yeah, if any of the images that I showed felt interesting, that could be helpful. I would say that Project Drawdown's Drawdown Review, published in 2020, available free online, is meant to be at a primer level around the possibilities for solutions to address warming and change the atmosphere. And it's written in such a way as to be as accessible as possible for somebody who's new to the solution side. The deeper aspects of transformative, climate beneficial type work, it's a good question. I don't know. There's an infographic image on the insetting that was in the presentation that I shared. Again, it can go out. I think that's a single image to capture, in general, the idea of looking at investments in the supply chain and what type of benefits might accrue from those types of investments compared to, say, offsets. That said, the major risk here, I'd say, is like the heterogeneous nature of organizations. When somebody's new to it, finding out the context they're coming from will be really important. Because there's just so many different industries and organizations and types of organizations that it's hard to have one generic image that captures everything.
Yeah, totally. I was just thinking of Kate Raworth's donut economics diagram that would be accessible to people who are new to the topic, and just the visual circular nature of the diagram is very much in alignment with regenerative economics and not exploiting and extracting all the value we can. Okay, so we are just at time, but quickly, what are three things you want the audience to take away from this conversation?
Resilience. I mean this for yourself as a person too. Just prepare extremism, whatever practices. 2020 probably felt like a crazy year and super hard. And I don't want to be too, just reflect on your experience of 2020 and whatever learnings you had from there, double down on those learnings to how to be resilient into the coming future, the imminent future. It's possible.
Yeah.
The other is outcome, the solutions and practices to actually return winter to the poles, to address the global warming. It's absolutely possible and feasible within the world of material. It's not science fiction. I think that's really important to ground into and tell your kids, you know, and just, it is possible. There's nothing that's physically impossible about addressing all this. And, I guess the third thing that I think is important is, I mentioned it in the offsets, but let's see, one of the beautiful realities that I'm sympathetic to is that addressing the social harm of colonialism and exploitation, white supremacy, and some of these other forces in society, addressing that, centering those who have been most marginalized and exploited, actually is the key to unlocking all the other reforms and resolves. So this transformation of society is as important as our environmental practices.
Right. Yeah. And we didn't even talk about labor or future of work, the just transition that is key to transitioning to a carbon neutral economy. We will have to continue the conversation another time, but we are also continuing this conversation on a Vantage Point future factors, our signals sprint in climate and finance. So we hope you'll continue adding signals to that. And Kevin, thank you so much for joining us. This was so great. I'm going to be thinking about those buildings for the rest of the day. And we hope to talk to you soon. And thank you, everyone, for joining us.